Okay, church. I'm going to give you guys 5 more seconds. 5. What a welcoming church. Get your coffee, get your seat. Yeah, I don't know, it's not working. It's okay. Okay, Ian's got his coffee. You know you don't need any coffee, Ian. You're preaching today. Well, good morning, church. Oh, that was so bad. Good morning, church. We got a packed house today. It's awesome. We are so excited to share about our Dominican. Who's excited for some testimony? All right. I don't know. Now I'm off. I'm really loud, so I can do this. We had the most amazing time. I couldn't even sleep last night because I couldn't wait to be able to share how good and faithful God was to us in the Dominican. We made a little video that we're going to show here in a second, but our mission was for us to go to the Dominican and partner with a local church that we could start to send you guys to the Dominican, to the local church, and help to love and to serve them, that we would begin to launch an international missions here where we are able to go. And so that happened. I felt like every step we took was ordered by the Lord. And I know you guys were praying for us because Ian didn't go to jail. I know, we can clap for that. You can clap for that. It was just so good. So we just made a little video to start, and we're going to have some testimony, but we're going to show the video. Just sit back and enjoy.
Two, three.
Jesus! How awesome was that? Woo. Okay, so we have 3 speakers. We need a miracle today. 3 speakers in 30 minutes, and Ian is beginning. but we're going to share our testimony with you, and I can't tell you enough about the Lord's blessing on our lives as we went there. I was reading through Deuteronomy 28 this morning, And it talks about when you're following the Lord, when you're being obedient to God, the blessing of God will overcome and overtake you. And that's how we felt in the Dominican, that everywhere we turned, the blessing of God was overwhelming us and overtaking us. Our steps were ordered from the relationships that we built to the churches that we visited, to the pastors that we were able to encourage, to the pastors that were able to encourage us, to the unity that we had together, and the vision that God gave us for this church. We walked in the fullness of his blessing. So right now, we're going to start the testimony with Mr. Ian. Can you give him a huge round of applause? He was absolutely a catalyst on the trip, and I know that's going to happen this morning. All right. Love you, buddy.
Do I really need a microphone?
No.
Hey, y'all. All right. Lord, whew. Oh, man, Lord, we just praise you. We praise you, Lord. Touch the lips of the people that are going to talk today, Lord. The men that went down there, Lord. Oh, it was so sweet, Lord. Your grace is so sweet that you poured out every single day, including today. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right. Yep. I got pages of stuff I can tell y'all about. But I'm not going there. We're going to see how the Holy Spirit goes in this. And let's see. Yep. I got it. And the guys already got this. I think they got get sent this to them yesterday. 1 Samuel 11, chapter 10, verse 26. And Saul also went home to Gibeah, and there went with him a band of men whose hearts God had touched. Let me tell y'all, the men I went with, God touched those men. God uses those men in their lives. And I got to witness it. I did. I am like the fish out of water. I don't travel. Just ask my wife. My idea of a vacation is turning the phone off and staying home. But Jamie's right. The Holy Spirit led us on this journey. He called Ian to leave the country for the first time. Never done it. When people, you know, I've been in various churches, and there's always, oh, we got a mission trip, and blah, 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 blah. And I was like, And I'm the guy, yep, I was the one in the pew that said, mission trip, we got enough stuff we need to do around here. Can I get an amen? Because, y'all, we got enough stuff we need to do around here. But the key is to go on a purpose to bless others. Because when you do that, those others that you're there to bless, to help, to seek, to find a way, they're the ones that bless you. Pastor Ellie, Jamie, dude, talk about a man that every second of every day is led by the Holy Spirit and acknowledges it verbally in front of whoever he's talking to. It blew it like in traffic. And y'all, traffic in the Dominican is different, okay? Praise God, someone else drove us. Because if Ian drove, and I'm a great driver, just ask my family. if Ian drove, people would have been hurt. I would have gone to jail, Jamie. You know I would have. But in the midst of all that chaos, there was Ellie. Oh, and you know, something would happen and delay us even more. Oh, praise be to God. Blah, blah, blah. And like, How can you praise God in this delay? But yeah, I'm that guy. And of course, I'm the couple days leading up to the trip, I began to look around. How on earth did I say yes to this? Really? Me and a bunch of surfer dudes? I've got nothing in common with, didn't grow up with them, blah, blah, not like nothing. But I'm going, you know, we've got pastor, worship, you know, the whole nine yards, and there I am. I'm the amen guy that sits over there, y'all. That's what I do. And glory, amen. So there's one person clapping. Before I went left, I prayed to the Lord. I said, Lord, open my eyes to see what you will have me see. Open my ears to hear. Open my heart to hear what you have to say to us, to our church. I told Jamie, I said, I'm there to pray. You know, that's my job. Ha! And y'all, I did pray. The folks, the prayer warriors that are in this church, and we got some, just so you know. I experienced prayer in a way I've never experienced before. I used to look at my mom or my sister, and they'd pray for like 10, 20. Oh, I was in prayer for almost an hour and blah, blah. And I'm sitting there, how on earth do you pray for an hour? I can't get past 5 minutes. I run out of stuff to say. You know, there's a miracle, Jamie. I run out of stuff to say. God opened I prayed the longest I've ever been in prayer before, and being in prayer is not what you say, it's just coming before the Lord and allowing yourself to be there, drinking in the fullness that He has for every one of you that are here. Well, on this trip, the Lord opened my eyes. I got to witness the men that I went with operating in the gifts that God had given each of them. The gifts of the Spirit, communication, the whole nine. I saw kids that didn't know Jamie running up to Jamie. And him that one of that picture of him being down there and hugging on the kids, he loved on all of them. It's just phenomenal. He's the one that, I'm the loud one, obviously, but Jesse's quiet. He observed. But when the Holy Spirit moves him, he's the one that goes to talk to the empanada lady. Next thing you know, she doesn't want to give him the leftover. She makes him a new one. And I'm talking about doesn't get it out of the freezer and put it in the toaster. She gets the dough and kneads it, rolls it out, stuffs it, folds it, crimps it, puts it in the fryer. That's the love of Christ that she had for Jesse. That's what that was about. And don't get me started on Brian. That dude blew me away. God brought him through the experiences of his life and prepared him for that trip, asking questions at various meetings that we had and drawing information out of those around us that were there with us. God connected him with two different organizations that I didn't know who they were. You know, Love Serves and Esperanza. I get the Love Serves. Esperanza, I think, means hope. Yep, got a nod. Yeah, glory. But yeah, it's just, honestly, it's my biggest thing. I've got a list of all these different things, miracles that happen, the whole nine yards. Like literally from the flight out, phone miracle, you know, and to the flight back, it was full. But really, in all of it, and I would encourage you all, not just pray about whether the Lord wants to send you or use you. But go. Go ye, you know, the scripture, what is it? Go ye therefore into all the world, right? Going on a trip like this, out of everything you know, language barrier, whole nine yards, it gave, what I drew from it the most that I want to share with y'all is I got a chance to experience God in His fullness every day. I got a chance to the body of Christ is edified when we talk about it, when we come together, and not just in church in a building, but when we're talking with a buddy on a Tuesday and the conversation ends up beginning to talk about God. And next thing you know, you're walking away with that and you're both energized and ready to go. That's what this does. When you're down there, when you're separated from a normal environment, it's you and the Lord. It is you and God. And it's those times that you get to experience Him in all of His fullness. You know, and I'll try and be brief, but one thing I found when I, you know, in hearing various, we met with various pastors and stuff like that, and their churches have the same issues that ours do. What makes their churches grow is the same thing that will make ours grow. It's not how many countries we go do missions with, how much money we put in the plate. That doesn't do anything. It is about getting out there. Each of you can share Christ with somebody that Jamie can't. They may never come to church, but they can experience Christ. They can experience God by their interactions with each of you. And the churches that are successful, that grow, aren't through programs and all that stuff that they do. It's literally them taking the church outside of the building into the world and wrapping their arms around their brothers and sisters and helping them. And next thing you know, I don't know, I just, you know, Bob was going to church and he came help me, and so I decided I'd come and check it out. You know, that's
true.
Yeah, it's, that's what happens. And next thing you know, they're coming to church. And y'all, church ain't saved nobody. Not the first person. Ain't saved a soul. Jesus Christ died to save everybody. Every single person. The people that don't like us, the people that sometimes we don't like. You know, I mean, I've got a few, okay? But that's how do we get it? How do we win? We love them. We meet them where they are. Jamie, we meet them where they are, and we love them. And, buddy, you taught me that. I used to see Jamie, I was like, there's that pretty boy from Liberty, you know? You know, when my wife told me that, she's like, found out who our new preacher's going to be. And I was like, who? And she's like, Jamie Smith. And I was like, great. You know, I'm just being honest, okay? You're the idiot who gave me a microphone. But what changed me? Well, when I got to know Jamie, when I went where Jamie was and got to know him. When we let people in out there and we get to know them and let them get to know us, they see the light of Christ that will save them. That is their only hope. It ain't the money we put in the offering pot.
It's that love, you know, that feeling you get. Ah, should I go say something to that guy? I've squashed that voice myself quite a bit. I've squashed it. I should probably say something, walk away, not saying a word. I pray the Lord strengthens each one of you to do what He's called each one of you to do. The gifts He's given unique to each one of you that I can't do, that Jamie can't do, that Kimber can't do, you can do. And how do you do that? Just being you. Love them. Love is what got you here. Somebody told you about the Lord. Why? Because they loved you. Because as imperfect as you are, they loved you and said, come on. There's a way. There is truth. There is a light. All right. Who's not? I don't even know who's next.
Yeah, glory.
Next. Okay. Buckle up. Here comes Brian.
Woo!
Yeah. Give him a hand. I love this guy. This guy came up to me after church and was like, hey, man, you want to grab a burger at Five Guys? Dude. Yeah, it was awesome.
Thank you. Thank you, Ian. Wow. That was powerful. I set my alarm, Jamie, to go from my rear end to buzz in 9 minutes. So, what a trip. Most of y'all, my motivation for going on this particular trip, I think, was different than Jesse and Ian and certainly Jamie's. Some of you may or may not know that I'm one of the 6 vestry members in our church. And if you don't know the Anglican faith, vestries are kind of like the elders. And we rotate on and off. 2 of us come on every year, and you vote as a member of the church. You vote on those vestry members, and then 2 rotate off. So I'm about to rotate off in October, along with Amy Robinson. And so my primary motivation to participate in this trip was really just to support, kind of be a wingman for Jamie. He's been sharing for over a year, ever since he accepted this opportunity, that one of his passions is that our church can experience international missions. And I was immediately in agreement. Our family's been blessed to go on mission trips literally all over the world, and a great number of them. And I can't even count the number of times that we've gone to the Dominican Republic. And in one particular year, we were fortunate enough to spend the whole month of July in the Dominican Republic. And I have a peace. I'm very comfortable in the Dominican Republic. Unlike Ian, who had never been out of the country, and Jesse, who's a world traveler in his own right, but he had never been to the Dominican Republic. But in a similar manner as Jamie and Kimber, who've spent a great deal of time in the DR, I'm like, this is something that I can do as a vestry member representing the vestry to just help coordinate and organize the trip. And when Jamie, you know, shared with the vestry that he really wanted this for our body, I'm like, hey, that's something that I can do to serve him and to serve each one of you. So I had the privilege of organizing this particular event. And my goal was really just to spend time with Jesse and with Ian, and we had hoped Jeremy, who unfortunately got the stomach bug the night before, and really just to get to know these awesome guys. And the way you do that is T-I-M-E. You got to spend time with one another. And often here at home, we don't take that time. So I think that's how I was personally blessed, just to better get to know Jesse and better get to know Ian. I could go on and on about how this particular trip impacted me personally, and I would love to do that. Open invitation. You let me know when you want to get together for coffee or Five Guys for lunch. I would love to get with you and share, regardless of where you're at in your relationship with the Lord, regardless of where you're at in your career, regardless of where you're at financially, regardless where you're at with your family, the ages of your children. I think we first took our first family mission trip was to the Dominican Republic with our church in Colorado. Zach was, I don't know, he was young, 3, 4, 5, I don't remember. He's not here, so I can share. I remember he was young enough to still wet the bed, because he did. And it was dramatic, very traumatic, when you don't have running water and you're somewhat camping and your youngest child wakes up in the middle of the night sleeping with Suzanne and I on an air mattress that had a little pinhole, so about 2 hours into the evening we're literally sleeping on concrete, and loses control, and it was a mess. But anyway, so I can share with each one of you, regardless of where you're at, how God could use you on a trip that we had the opportunity to experience. And literally anyone can go. Another ulterior motive that I had, I didn't share, was that I had a hope that maybe Jesse or Ian would be inspired to serve on our missions committee. Many people are not aware that Vestry, over the last year, ever since Jamie's become our senior pastor, we've been slowly trying to implement changes in the way we govern and the way we allocate resources. And, you know, prior to Jamie joining the church, literally, guys, if you're new to, I just met Mario, he said he's been coming since last year, our church has more than tripled in the last 18 months. And glory to God for that, right? And for the first time, we have a full-time administrative assistant in Kara, full-time. Chris has faithfully served full-time, but not on a full-time salary. Now we have both of them. We have a full-time youth pastor. And so, and recently, the Vestry approved that we're going to step out in faith as a church, and we're allocating 15% of our annual budget to missions. And that's huge. So in that process, we need help from the Vestry. We need help to gather information and to make decisions on how to best allocate that. So we have a missions committee, and we're trying to implement the missions committee in a similar way how the Vestry rotates, at least have 6 members where two rotate on and two rotate off. We're trying to implement a very similar structure in the missions committee. And so, but a little less formal, where the missions committee among themselves decides who to bring onto the committee and which ones to rotate off. So it's kind of a new structure, but it's new to our church, and we need to implement it so that there is a consistency, yet new blood's coming in so that we can change and things like that. Well, my ulterior motive was that since none of the missions committee could participate for a variety of reasons, you know, career, family, finances, whatnot, I was really hopeful that Jesse and Ian might feel compelled to serve when the opportunity comes up to serve on that missions committee. So that was really my motivation. But the things that really touched me on this particular trip, in addition to getting to know these guys, was just partnering with some of the organizations like Love Serve, Esperanza, Christian Surfers, we saw and got to experience some things that really just blew my mind. I woke up this morning at 2 o'clock, couldn't go back to sleep for an hour, thinking about a mom, a young woman that we met who's part of Esperanza, which is a microfinance organization where they lend money to local Dominicans, and in this case, a Haitian community. And she was sitting there outside of her home. She had had a large bowl of beans, fresh beans, that she was shucking. And stop, that was my 9-minute marker. But to wrap up, she was basically, her business was buying beans, shelling them, bagging them, and selling them. That's her business. While she was doing that, she was holding a little baby that, to me, he was clothless, and I thought he was probably 2 or 3 months old, and he wasn't acting normal. And I asked the question, how old is your son? And she said that he was 2 years old. And I'm like, how can that be? That this, we have our first grandchild who's 6 months old and is bigger than this two-year-old. And I woke up this morning and it just dawned on me, wonder what, you know, she indicated that he was sick, obviously. And I'm like, what was wrong with that little boy? And I don't know. I reached out to our friends and partners at Esperanza earlier this morning to see if they could find out, hey, remember that lady and the little boy? Can you find out what was wrong with him? And she replied back earlier and today and said, yeah, she would find out. But I'm like, he just looked like he was malnourished. Maybe there's something significantly more complicated than that, but I just woke up. It was almost like a nightmare. What can we do to serve that community? And as Jamie indicated, we did find a church that my last and final point, hope and point, is that we would return back and report to you in a united way that we have identified a church that can help us. For any of us that want to go back, they can help us coordinate a trip, because it's when you have boots on the ground, it's significantly easier than trying to organize a trip for a larger group of them four and do it in an impactful way, use our time wisely, use our resources. And I think we're all in agreement that we found a church outside of Puerto Plata that could help us. Literally, they go out into the community about 3 hours away up into the mountains and do exactly what we're hoping to do in Puerto Plata. So anyway, it was a very, very successful trip. It was certainly life-changing for each one of us. And I would encourage each one of you to be in prayer about next time we go, might you or your family join us. So with that, I'll turn it over to Jesse.
Thanks, Brian. Feel like I need a guitar in front of me. Might be a little more comfortable, but no, it was an amazing trip. God showed up, and I guess I want to open it with, you know, you guys. We came before we left. We came and prayed. Poor Jeremy was up here with us, but for some reason, God didn't want him to go because he texted us at 1 in the morning, 2 in the morning, said, "I'm sick. I'm not going anywhere." But the church has been praying, and it was very obvious that our steps were directed by the Lord, and it was like truly because everyone was praying for us here. I got so many texts, you know, praying for you guys, Joe and Esther, and then you guys all prayed for us before we left, and it And it really was clear that God was doing, was going to do something with us, and we showed up. It just kind of automatically started to happen. And Jamie asked me a while ago to go, and I just said yes, because I was like, sure, I don't know where we're going or what we're going to do, but I was like, yeah, it's February, I want to leave. But no, other than that, I have felt a personal, God's been dealing my heart of like some getting involved with missions in some way. It's easier, I think, to, it's not easy, but living here, you can support a ministry financially, right? That's like obviously one way. But another thing is to actually leave the comfort of your home and your family and your surroundings and everything you know and actually go somewhere that you've never been, which I love to do that. I used to travel all over the world, and that was like my favorite thing to do. But I had never been to the Dominican Republic, and personally, I don't really like the Caribbean that much. I've been there a bunch of times, and it's not like a favorite place of mine, so I wasn't really excited about going there, and God like really changed my heart. I've always felt like, yeah, this is cool, it's warm, there's waves, but it's not for me. I'd rather be in the South Pacific or even somewhere cold. So it was neat for me because I wasn't really excited about necessarily the destination, which I think was kind of cool, but then God showed up, and the people there, Jamie kept telling me, like, these people are so nice, and every time I travel, you know, the locals, when they see a gringo, they just have their hands out, and they're like, gimme, 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 gimme. And we went to some really poor places, and that did not happen one time. Not one person saw us and just said, gimme your money. So it was, Jamie was right, the people there are truly genuine. I know there's been, I don't know, a couple years ago, I remember about hearing about people getting kidnapped in the Dominican Republic from resorts. Don't worry, you're not going to get kidnapped. It's very safe. But all in all, just like these guys said, God showed up. And it was amazing to see Ian. He took a huge step of faith. And he didn't tell you this, but when we checked in, Jamie and I almost missed our flight because we didn't fill out some form. We were like, what form? It doesn't matter. And we got to the desk. We had to fill it out online. She was like, well, you'll probably miss your flight, but it's all right. You got to fill it out anyway. So we barely made it. And then we get through security, and Ian is over there, and it does not look good. He's like completely stressed. He's pale. It's like 4 in the morning anyway. And he's like, I lost my phone. My phone is somewhere in the security line. Somebody probably stole it. And he's just like, you know, he's devastated. He's taken the step of faith, never left the country. And his only lifeline to his family, which and home, is now lost. And so we're like, it'll be all right. You know, of course, if we lost our phone, it wouldn't be all right. But for Ian, you know, it's all right, man. You don't need it. And but he's not too happy, but he's like, he's still walking in faith, and we're walking to the gate. And I was like, man, I just felt so bad for him. I was like, Lord, I just pray that we can find his phone. I'm going to call it one time before we leave and see if somebody answers it. Maybe they picked it up. And so I put it on speaker, and sure enough, some guy's like, is this Ian's phone, or is this, do you know Ian? And I was like, Ian, they found your phone. And so we turned around, because we talked to the TSA agent, and they told us they would look for it. And so sure enough, this TSA agent is coming, walking down, he's got Ian's phone, and it was a miracle. He found God's phone, found Ian's phone. And so Ian grabs the TSA agent. You know, Ian's a big dude, right? And this guy's like my size. And this TSA agent in his uniform, Ian just wraps his arms around him, gives him a big old bear hug. And I said, I don't think any TSA agent in the history of the world has ever been hugged by another person. So that was a miracle in itself, too. But yeah, God showed up in so many ways. And the prayer was answered. We connected with a church, and we also connected with another individual who has helped Christian surfers in the past, and he speaks English. He's from Long Beach. His name is Alan. He was the kind of orangish, strawberry, blonde hair guy in there. And he's been through a whole lot in his family recently. But between Alan, who has lived there for 15 years, and this church, we have a place that we can now, and it doesn't matter, like they said, there's someone for everybody. Man, woman, child, we're all going to the Dominican at some point, because we have just found people that we connected with. And and this is for the ladies, when the Esperanza, they were all women who worked for the organization, and they were amazing. They were so sweet. And there's this one handicapped girl. I couldn't really tell what was wrong with her. She was handicapped and she was also special needs. And one of the ladies in Esperanza, and she lived in a village, she had her feet were all muddy, and she was her grandmother, I think, took care of her. But one of the ladies from Esperanza, as soon as she heard her voice, she just was screaming, and the lady just went and hugged her and held her and bought her cookies and got her a drink from the local store. And these women just love these people. And so when we go there, you ladies will connect with them in a heartbeat. And there's stuff for the kids too. I mean, I'm sure these kids in these villages would love to meet kids from our village, quote unquote. It's really, really exciting. And Jamie's vision for our church, our mission statement is love God, love people, and live on mission. But we've never had an international missions trip. And not that we don't live on mission here locally, and there's nothing wrong with that. But I think something is to be said about going, which is the Great Commission in Matthew, is go to all nations and make disciples. So I think our nation for the time being is the Dominican Republic for our church. And I think as we kind of organize trips and start getting people down there, I think you guys will feel the same way. So it's really, really exciting what's ahead. And God be the glory. As Ian says, glory, glory. Hey, one more story about Ian, because this, All right, so we get there in Santo Domingo, and we're with this organization called Love Serves, which they do amazing things. They train pastors who then affect their community, and they train them how to disciple people. I think that's a big problem, is there's lots of churches there, and you can get excited and just tell people about Jesus, but actually discipling the church so that people will then go out into their community and as strong Christians and bring them to the church. That's what this organization does. So mainly we get there, and it's all Baptist, Southern North Carolina people they're Western North Carolina. So they got deep Southern accents, but they're a bunch of Baptist men that were here to meet up with Love Serves as well. And so we get there. We've been up since 2 in the morning, and we go have dinner and meet with a bunch of these pastors and a bunch of local Dominicans. And they go around, they kind of ask everybody to give a little, where are you from, what do you do kind of thing. And Ian's one of the last ones. And I don't even know what he said, but but before you know it, there's 20 people, Southern Baptist men and a bunch of Dominicans. And when he's finished, the whole room is clapping, literally clapping. And everyone else is like, hello, my name is Jesse. I'm from the Outer Banks of North Carolina, and Ian's got them all fired up and clapping. So what's cool about what Ian said and what Brian is saying is that we all have a gift, right? God has all given us a certain personality and certain talents and gifts. And it is to edify the body of Christ. And so it's not the Ian show, it's not the Jamie show or the Jesse or Brian show, it is the body of Christ. So we're all different, and we all have something to give to somebody, and we all need each other too. I'm pretty sure that's all I have to say, but And in closing, we're gonna go. We're going back. We're gonna get organized and get this thing together. And we're excited to see what God has for the future for us going to the Dominican for our church in the Outer Banks. So, Colin, it is time for communion, my friend. But yeah, thank you guys so much for praying, and yeah, we'll just keep praying about what God has. The band's going to come up, and Colin is now going to lead us in communion as a church together. So what a better way to celebrate the body of Christ with each other as we celebrate what God's doing.